really it's a very interesting sitting here and thinking about journeys, because of course when this institution was founded, the Royal Charter expressed the imperialism, really, of Britain at that time. And my journey actually in this field began through the Institute of Education in London. I didn't know if you know that, Elaine. I was studying there, and I went out to an area called Nyaminyami in Zimbabwe, where the Tonga people had been forcibly resettled at the building of the Kariba Dam. I was looking at the imbalance in enrollment between boys and girls, and I was planning to continue to do academic work. I was a novice in this field. It was my very first trip, in fact, to Africa, but I was studying human rights and education. And that experience really was a very strong, visceral experience, because when I arrived in the village of Mola, I saw a level of poverty that I had never witnessed before. And somehow it felt inappropriate that I was there to ask questions and study the problem. And I was somewhat thrown back into myself and questioning my own capabilities in this. After about day six, I decided that all my questionnaires, which I labored over, were going to be given as scrap paper to the local secondary school. And at that point, I really began again, because what I was expecting to find in the area was the confirmation of what was then perceived to be the cause of girls' exclusion from education, and that was the resistance of families to the education of girls. Now, of course, I was looking at one community in one country in sub-Saharan Africa, but it was a very traditional community, and I thought, well, if this is what I'm hearing here, then perhaps it pertains elsewhere. And what I heard was that poverty was at the root of girls' exclusion, that families wanted their daughters to go to school. I talked to the chief, I talked to teachers, I talked to parents, I talked to children themselves. And with one voice, they said the same thing, and that was, we want girls to go to school, we want our daughters to go to school, but we don't have the means. So when you look at and looked at the family budget, clearly there was a decision being taken at the family level. But that decision, when you looked at budgets, actually made sense. Because here you have a level of poverty which means a level of vulnerability, which means that every financial decision has a bearing on survival itself. So the, for example, families would go to the clinic. If they were told that their child, family member, was extremely sick and needed to go to the hospital you had to go on a jeep up to the lake shore, Lake Kariba, go on a boat to Lake Kariba Hospital. It took about 10 hours to make that journey. The government paid for that journey. The problem began if a family member died, because then there was a crisis. They would not be able to afford to bring the family member back and bury them at their home. And that would have been a huge, an emotional crisis. And it was going to be impossible in financial terms. So given that that level of decision-making was taken in the context of the family for boys and girls, it meant that, you know, boys had a better chance of future paid work. The labour market favoured boys. They could go and work on the commercial farms and fisheries. Girls were much more protected. And they, as a result of that enforced decision, it wasn't in effect a choice, it was Hobson's choice, meant that girls were heavily outnumbered by boys in the school system. So I was seeing the results of poverty. And there were seven boys for every girl at school in Mola Secondary School at that time. So I came back with a very different understanding in this particular community of what I perceived as the problem. And I went to talk as a family. Now we decided that we would help some girls to get into the school system and remain there. So it was to be a family initiative. And I went to see various development organizations. And looking back, I can absolutely see, you know, that I was green as the grass. I was incredibly naive. But I did expect, at some level, I think, to get a kind of response, which was, okay, let's take a look at this. But universally, it was like, you're barking up the wrong tree here. The community has told you what they thought you wanted to hear. Even if you begin and they say their daughters can go to school after 6 months, they'll be pulled out. So there was no cooperation going to happen at that level. So I went back. I finished my study and I went back to Mola. And this was time the mobile phones, I arrived. And I said, right, I'm here. You said, you know, you wanted to your daughters to go to school here. Can we work together? So the Chief Mola, called a community meeting. And so 36 hours later, I sat in Mola Secondary School and literally hundreds of people came. Now, when you look out across the landscape, you can't see a large population. You wouldn't think, because the land is so poor that people have to have a large amount of land in order to sustain the family. So they are spread out. So, you know, I was shocked to see, you know, so many people come to the meeting. But the very fact that they were coming, that the chief had sent out the message, meant that there was great interest, and that was a confirmation. So we said, well, we can't have a meeting like this every time there's a decision to be taken. How do we move forward? So over that day, in effect, the Mola community designed the basis for the Camfed model, which was that this is about the ownership of the community by the community of the problem and of the solution. And the various forms of capital, if you like, that are brought to bear on the problem, the social capital of the chief, and his network, generally his. It's generally, you know, male chief, though not exclusively so. The faith-based leadership. The different groups, like the mothers groups, and that social capital, that kind of way of community operating and communicating with itself, within itself, became one of the resources. The institutional capital of the chieftaincy itself, of the school system. We were working within the government school system with the permission of the government, of the Ministry of Education. The knowledge capital, utterly crucial for success, basic common sense. But that knowledge capital is often surprisingly overlooked. The understanding of the communities of the depth of poverty and how it impacts on their lives. So all these came together in that day, and it was decided that the initiative should not be solely in the hands of the education system, of the school, of the education officers, but should be an inclusive one. After all, health relates to education. The safety of schools the safety of girls in the community relates to education. The power of the chiefs in terms of promoting change and their ability to negotiate that change with the community. All these things came together that day, and so the community decided to have this very inclusive committee with all this representation of the various constituencies. And that remains, and those, when you talk, Louise, about the communities we work with, every single community has a committee of that kind. And what that has become is a network of volunteer activists. Now, the word volunteer doesn't actually capture it, because people don't volunteer to Camfed. People are committed to the issue of girls' education and the inclusion of girls in education, and they bring their own expertise, their own resources to the table. Not one is paid. And I've been told on many occasions that you can't get people to turn up for meetings unless you pay them. Not so. I say, you can come with me and see what's happening. So those were the early days, and then it was about thinking, well, the material costs of education can be met in a very holistic way. So, school uniforms, shoes, but also provided in a way that respects the child. The individual, the dignity of the child. Now, when poor people are treated with indignity, all it does is confirm their own sense of their own inadequacy. And the sector of international development does often take a very risk-averse position in its work and actually determines what resources are going to be given at what point and puts in place significant layers of bureaucracy. Now, what happens is people are infantilized. Adults are infantilized. Adults, you know, almost, you know, take the benefits that are on offer. We reversed that and said, actually, the child is not the beneficiary, she is the client. She is Camfed's client. Language matters because it actually creates a culture, you know, an organizational culture in which people are thinking about doing things in different ways. So she gets a uniform that fits when she needs it. She gets a pair of shoes that are strong shoes. When she has a health problem, she knows where to go. So what we have done is created within the school system a network of teacher mentors. They are paid by the government, but we provide training in psychosocial support. So if a child, for example, is bereaved, which is a common experience in the children we support, then she gets the social support within the school system. She has a concerned adult. She knows where to go. She doesn't have to think about the, you know, the office, the Camfed office in Harare or Lusaka, but she actually has someone there on the doorstep. And that individual, if they feel they can't, you know, help the girl to the extent they need to, then they will ask for the support of Camfed's team. And Camfed's teams in five countries are, by policy, all recruited from within that country. We had a policy from the outset, just to tangentially. When I started to have a look at the way the sector was operating, organizations at that time, this was many years ago, it's changed now, but at that time in 1991, you would find often white directors coming in from, you know, their own home countries in the UK or the US, and then maybe even a white deputy, and then you would have the rest of the team recruited. It looked to me like a very neo-colonial model. And so from the outset, I said, no expat staff, and we actually established Camfed Zimbabwe simultaneously with Camfed UK as peer organizations, both with their own body of trustees. So that's a reflection of, you know, how we think organizationally and about structures and practice and what that says about the organization's policies and principles. So the teams are there. They're there for communities to draw upon. And, of course, there's a very high level of engagement with communities. So we have large numbers of peer groups among chiefs, among head teachers. So these head teachers and chiefs, for example, who work with us, become advocates of the work. Not the work of Camfed, if you like, branded in that way, but of the work of promoting girls' education and supporting girls' education, and often changing the culture within the school system. Because it's not only about getting girls into school. Schools are often, you know, largely male environments. Mainly male teachers, majority of boys. Girls participate as a minority, as a result of which they don't necessarily do well academically. This is about saying you are as important as everyone else in the school system, and the teachers and the head teachers, and particularly important around the leadership, getting behind this idea. So those peer groups then are moving forward with us in terms of expansion. So a head teacher will work with a neighboring school. A chief will work in a neighboring country. So when we expanded, for example, from Zimbabwe, we expanded to Ghana, we expanded then to Zambia, the team that led the expansion were people from the communities as well as the national level team that worked with us. So the team, for example, that went to Zambia was the Permanent Secretary of Education, actually, in Zimbabwe, who could, you know, explain to his counterparts just how this was working. The chief, Chief Mutakedza from Zimbabwe, could explain to his counterparts how things were working and the kind of challenges and how they'd been overcome. And so this is about building. So when you have this capital, which is enabled, of course, by financial capital, you have it grows exponentially. because it is about recognising all the capital that exists and enabling it to grow and respecting it. So you have a kind of internal culture which it multiplies. So that is, I think, one of the factors that the OECD, you know, have looked at, the scalability, because you can scale when from principles, and what we scale from are the application of principles. And one of the, I think, most exciting evolutionary steps, in 1998, I work with Lucy Lake. She joined me very early on. She was a young graduate when I was starting out as a kind of mature student with a young family. And she joined me. And so we were working together in Zimbabwe. And we could see that the first group of girls were going to come out of education to a job market that, you know, wasn't there. So what was going to happen? Now, of course, as we know, the benefits of girls' education, every year of education multiplies the benefits. So at the very least, we had extended the emotional, psychological, and physical period, you know, the growth of an adolescent girl. She was, you know, would have otherwise left school at the age of 13 or 14, because it's 7 years of primary school education in sub-Saharan Africa, often starting aged seven when you can actually walk a sufficient distance to school. So coming out of school, 13, 14. And what we were doing was saying, no, we will extend through secondary school education. So it's a very, you're in a very different position to come out, the school system, to be in effect, to have your childhood extended. Because when you come out into the adult world, in effect, at the age of 13 and 14, you are virtually considered to have the role of an adult. You have reached, in many eyes, a marriageable age. You have reached puberty. You have the domestic and agricultural skills that you have been taught in the family. So you are very capable. And then as a result of which, many girls actually begin what are in effect start adult responsibilities very young. And they begin their lives of domestic and agricultural labor and marry and start their childbearing years very young. Now, you talked, Louise, about the fact that we're about to meet the goals. What we have is an ever-moving target. We have an ever-moving target because if a girl comes out of school at 13 or 14, there is no money available for her at home to extend her education in any way, to provide her with training. It means that she is likely, quite likely to marry in the deep, you know, in the far-flung rural areas. She will begin her childbearing years, age 15, 16. She is small in stature because of often malnutrition. So she has the stature more of a, you know, a child here, say 11 or 12. She experiences immense problems in pregnancy and childbirth. It's where we see the high rates of maternal mortality. It's that adolescent age group that are particularly affected. And she now gives birth to a new generation born into poverty. So she becomes the unwitting purveyor of poverty to the next generation. And that means that this, you know, these generational cycles are really very close. You know, meet many 35-year-old grandmothers. And so this targets, government targets, are ever-growing. And as fast as they create places, train teachers, build schools, the numbers are growing. If we actually recognized the power, aside from the justice, of course, the absolute justice of girls' education, but the power of girls' education to enable the international community and governments to actually, you know, address child mortality, maternal mortality, food security, population growth. It is you know, it is the about cutting through the Gordian knot. You know, it is a solution. The investment in girls' education pays the most enormous dividends. And of course, when the economists recognized this, that's when we got started getting movement and, you know, the Millennium Development Goals. But until then, it wasn't an economic issue. It was a rights-based issue. It was slightly, you know, slightly marginal issue. But it is center stage now. And you can see it. You know, it plays out. And that was what was playing out, of course, in that first community I went to in Mola. So Lucy and I said, we cannot now just say we've made this investment in girls' education. Yes, they've got all these benefits, but actually they're going to walk away with these benefits, but they're not necessarily going to be able transformers of their families, their communities. Thank you very much. So we established an alumni. I remember sitting in Cambridge University, rather lecture hall, rather like this, and a guy back saying to me, well, will they find anybody who wants to marry them if they're educated? Okay. Interesting question, sitting in Cambridge University. And actually what this was about was enabling them to take a different position in society and to create a network around them. So we said, right, if the most powerful groups in the world, what do they do to consolidate their power? They establish alumni. So we started an alumni for rural girls in Africa. It is a network that is united by a background of rural poverty, proud of their background, proud of their roots, and committed to change. So we have now got a generation, I'm going to end now, 35, the first who went into school, 35 years of age, Angeline Murmirwa, she is the regional director for Camfed in Africa, responsible for Tanzania, Zambia, Malawi, and Zambia, did I say Zambia? Tanzania, Malawi, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. She's from Zimbabwe. She was the chief negotiator on the massive investment of the UK government into our work in the first phase in Zimbabwe. So she was on the stage with the Minister of Education announcing the investment for 24,000 girls to go to school. She was once, you know, a barefoot child who had no hope of even going on to secondary education. What a loss. And when you multiply the loss to her family, her community, what it would have been, the world, then you see the scale of the utter tragedy that we're facing.
Thank you very much indeed, Anne. Thank you. Can I ask you a quick question? Mm-hmm. You talked about the way that you know, aid being given to developing countries is often attached to lots of bureaucracy. It's done in a way that can infantilize adults. How have you managed to persuade people who surely must, you know, you need money from somewhere to start, at least, you know, the seed funding for this kind of work.
Yes.
How do you manage to persuade funders to give you money on the basis that you want to do things in a different way?
Mm. Well, you know, in the early days, it was tough, of course. You know, I had no track record, and we didn't have an evidence base. But we quickly built an evidence base. We had the evidence that girls, you know, that were enrolling, that they were attending school consistently, parents were not pulling them out of the school system. We, of course, after the first group, we had the examination results. And so we had our evidence base that it was working, and it was working in a very traditional, very poor community. So we built from there. And of course, over the years, we have, you know, garnered partners of many, many kinds. And, you know, they can see the evidence. We have the evidence now. We have the evidence base, and they can see the reality. So we have, you know, I told you a story, the story of Evangeline. And of course, the stories are what connect us. But it's actually the evidence and the gathering of evidence that's actually going to take us to another level. So, you know, we have major corporations investing heavily in our work, the MasterCard Foundation being one, partnership with Goldman Sachs. You know, these are, you know, serious foundations looking very hard, you know, at their return, if you like, and they, what they see is a model that's really working. So, you know, so one study we did, we looked at Malawi, and we found that of the girls supported in our program in Malawi, 5% of the age group became mothers, teenage mothers, during the period, against 27% nationally. Mm. So you can see immediately what education is doing to protect girls from early pregnancy. And so we have that evidence base, and so we are very, very serious about our research, about our data, but also about articulating the practices of our model, the way that you can design a finance system that is accountable to the client, the way you can design a data system that is accountable to the client, the way you think about the questions that you are going to ask a child and the way you ask them, which actually recognizes her emotional vulnerability. So, you know, it's growing, it's grown massively and is continuing to grow.
And just one more question before I ask Elaine to do her piece. Do you think that, well, it sounds as though your model has disproved the assumption that it is actually parents who are resistant to children, to girls going to school because of their intense vulnerability and the fact that these are life and death decisions potentially for their survival. Do you think you have convinced funders and other organisations that aim to do work on education with girls that it is not resistance but poverty that is preventing girls from going to school?
Many, right. Many. I think I don't think we talk about poverty and justice enough. We focus on early marriage, let's say. You know, we focus on what is a result of poverty and injustice. We need to put poverty and injustice at the core of our understanding and of our action. And, you know, unless we do that, I think we will continue to fail, because technical solutions are not going to achieve the results. And, of course, in all our dialogue with the UK Department for International Development, I mean, those are very serious discussions. And I have seen an evolution, not least, Elaine, because of, you know, your work and, you know, the evolution of the thinking within government. But, you know, sometimes I think there's almost a vested interest, and I'm not talking about governments alone, but in a way in the global community, in saying, oh my goodness, you know, why don't these people, you know, these people take decisions that make sense? You know, you see it in the punitive cultures around legislation and around policy around poor people. You know, let's continue to take away, but let's actually think of ourselves. You know, the one thing that unites us as human beings is our vulnerability. And who knows, you know, where we will be tomorrow. And when, you know, when this building was, you know, thriving and established, you know, Dickens was writing. And he knew and understood poverty. He had experienced it. He had been in that blacking factory. His father was in prison. He never recognized it publicly. He was shamed by it, because in Victorian Britain, it was shameful to be poor. I think that's the world we are still living in.